Join me in welcoming Dr. Vaillancourt to do her presentation.
So I can tell that you're a lot younger than we are, because when they were saying which high schools they were from, I couldn't even hear them. So I'm going to talk about bullying and harassment, and I'm going to link it first to mental health. Then I'm going to talk about why we have differences in outcome, and I'm going to talk a little bit about the neuroscience behind that. So just in terms of putting things in perspective, if we think about mental health difficulties among Canadian children, we know that about 15 to 20% of children and youth in Canada have serious mental health problems. So this would mean about 15 to 20% would meet diagnostic criteria for a mental health disorder. The thing about mental health issues is that they typically begin in childhood. So about 50 to 75% of adults who have mental health difficulties, their difficulties began in childhood before the age of 15. Mental health problems in youth are the leading cause of health-related burden. And in adults, according to the World Health Organization, depression is the leading cause of disability worldwide. So this has now trumped cardiovascular problems. So people who study mental health, if you're interested in your future career, I encourage you to really think about going into mental health, the field of mental health. So my call for action for the adults in the room, but especially for the young people in the room, is if we want to reduce this issue, so the burden of mental health problems and the high prevalence rate that we see in Canada, I think we actually need to reduce bullying. I think bullying should be a public health initiative. And the reason why I say this is because the research that is done by people like myself and other scientists from around the world suggests that bullying causes mental health problems. And I know that most people won't make such a statement unless there's an empirical study that has a randomization or some sort of design like that. But we also know from longitudinal studies where we control for symptomology at time one and we look at the effects of bullying moving forward that it does seem to be the case. So study after study from around the world is suggesting that bullying causes mental health problems. So what is bullying? When we're talking about bullying, I think the best definition in the world is to use the Ministry of Education's definition. So the Ontario Ministry of Education has a definition. Every school in Ontario is compelled to use it through Bill 13. And basically what it's saying is that it's negative actions that are repeated. So they're directed at somebody by somebody else who has more power than them. And it's done over and over again. The problem with bullying or harassment is that the term is overly applied. So people will say if they were teased in a way that they didn't quite like, that they were being bullied. So all these incivilities that we see happen, we tend to use the term bullying. But it actually doesn't do justice to the kind of work that I do or the suffering that children have as a consequence of this, because I'm talking about the end of the spectrum. I'm talking about kids who and youth, teens, who get this every single day of their life, and they cannot defend themselves because they have less power. In terms of the scope of the problem with bullying, about 35% of Canadian children and teenagers report that they've been bullied within the past 2 months, occasionally. Of those 35%, 10% are bullied on a daily basis. So every day they go to school, they're treated poorly by their peers. And this means that about half a million, so 500,000 children and youth in Canada have that miserable existence on a daily basis. Canada doesn't actually have much to be proud of. In the latest UNICEF report, where they compared economically advantaged countries, what they found was that Canada ranked in the top third of the worst offenders. And in another study where they used surveillance study comparing these rich nations on their bullying's prevalence rates, what they found was that almost all of the countries had reductions in bullying over the last 12 years, with the exception of Canada and the UK. Our bullying rates actually increased when everybody else in the world seems to be going down. So we need to be doing something about this. We need to be doing something about it because, as I mentioned, it causes mental health difficulties. So if you look at this collection of issues that are associated with bullying, you see that children and youth who are bullied have academic difficulties. So they don't want to go to school. So there's increased absenteeism and truancy. They have somatic complaints. So they complain of stomach aches and headaches and the like. They have stress-related illnesses, and they even have bona fide physical health problems. They're more likely to get colds and flus and the like. They have low self-esteem, depression, social withdrawal and isolation, social anxiety, loneliness, suicide, and aggressive behavior. Our recent study that we published in the Journal of Developmental Psychology following kids forward from the time they were in grade 5 until the end of grade 8, what we found was that kids started on a trajectory of being victimized and then became bullies in the future. So when kids get bullied, they either become sad or they get mad. Now the thing about this is that recent studies have been following people from when they're really little up until they're quite old, and what they've shown is that the effects of bullying in childhood are long-standing. So in this study that was recently published in the American Journal of Psychiatry, what they did was they followed people who were bullied in childhood and those who weren't, and compared their outcomes, health outcomes, at 50 years later. And what they found was that those who had been bullied in childhood fared worse, even 50 years after the fact. In fact, their health outcomes, their mental health outcomes, were as bad as those who had been institutionalized in foster care or who had experienced other childhood adversities, such as extreme poverty or child maltreatment. Now this raises the question, what is the temporal sequence? I've kind of already given the answer away, but you know, a lot of people ask me this. Is it the case that kids are bullied and then become unwell as a consequence of that poor treatment? Or is it the case that the peer group's picking up on the fact that they're unwell to begin with, they bully them, and then they become more unwell as a consequence of that poor treatment? Most of the studies suggest that the temporal sequence is that first one, that kids become unwell as a consequence of being bullied. There's a handful of children that absolutely exist where you see a symptom-driven pathway where some children and youth have mental health difficulties to begin with, the peer group picks up on that, and they treat them poorly. But for the most part, Canadian children are mandated to attend school for 6 hours in the day, and they attend school with, you know, all the hopes and aspirations that you would want for them, and they get derailed because their peers treat them poorly. Now, just one concrete example. So if you look at all of the collection of studies here, these are all gold standard studies, following kids forward from one time to another, holding their symptoms, mental health difficulties constant at time one, and the like. And these studies, over and over again, including meta-analyses, suggest that peer victimization leads to increases in depression and anxiety in ensuing years. Now, having said that, if that's the temporal sequence, we also know that not all children fare, some fare better and some fare worse. So not all children become ill as a consequence of being treated poorly. So my current research interest is understanding the moderators. So I'm really interested in understanding why is it that some kids have poor outcomes when they're bullied and others seem to do better when they're bullied. And there's a bunch of studies suggesting several different moderators, environmental characteristics such as being in a better home. Some children who are bullied are maltreated in their home, so it's kind of like a double whammy. Studies have shown that if you're treated poorly by your peers but you have a good home life, your outcomes seem to be better. The classroom also seems to matter. Studies have shown that kids, if they're the only person being bullied in their classroom, they tend to do worse than kids where there's a lot of kids who are bullied in the classroom. It seems like an awful way to handle this, where we want more kids to be victimized, but the identity or the attribution of the person who's the only one being victimized, their attribution is it must be me. Whereas if a lot of people are being bullied in their classroom, they think that it must be the person who's doing it to them. Personal characteristics also matter. So gender seems to be a really important one. For example, in one study, being relationally victimized, so being excluded from the peer group and the like, at any frequency was associated with suicidal attempts for adolescent girls. But for teenage boys, it was only when it was at the extreme end of that continuum. And in another study, internalizing problems like depression and anxiety persisted for girls after the bullying had stopped, whereas for boys, that wasn't the case. Once the bullying had stopped, their mental health had improved. I'm particularly interested in the neurobiology of peer victimization and understanding biological vulnerability. And I'm going to give you one example, and then I think I'm done with my time. So in a, there was a study published in 2003 in one of the biggest journals in the world, Science. It was published by Caspi et al., where they looked at a polymorphism of the 5-HTT-LPR gene. So this is a serotonin transporter gene, and there's a polymorphism on whether or not you would have a long gene, long, short, or short. So they looked at people who had been maltreated in childhood, so the worst experiences of maltreatment you can imagine, so severe maltreatment, and they looked at the effects of having this type of gene on the outcome of being depressed at age 26. And what they found was that if the person had been severely maltreated in childhood and had the short 5-HTT-LPR gene, polymorphism of their 5-HTT gene, they had about a 70% chance of being depressed at age 26. If they had the exact same experience, so they were treated poorly by their caregivers, so this is severe maltreatment, and they had a protective gene, a long gene, their chances of being depressed at age 26 was no greater than if they hadn't been abused. This has been replicated in four recent studies looking at kids who are bullied. So kids who are bullied, who have the short risk gene for depression, in this one study by Benjent, girls who were bullied by other girls in a relationally way, so excluded from the peer group and the like, were three times more likely to be depressed if they had a short 5-HTT-LPR than if they had a long. So when we think about heterogeneity and outcomes, we also have to think that there is also some invisible scars, or that the experience of bullying can get under the skin and confer a risk for future health outcomes. And this is critical for the work that I do in terms of policy, because a lot of times people don't want to act because they'll use that one kid who was bullied and seem to have fared well. You know, we always have those motivation speakers who come out and say, you know, I'm a multimillionaire, pardon me, a billionaire now. I'm a gazillionaire, and I was bullied, and because I was bullied, I'm all the better for it. And we use those people as examples of not having to do anything. We're apathetic because we say, you see, there's something about that person. They're constitutionally strong, and this made them a better person. And then we then blame the person who's not doing well, and we say there must be something wrong with them. But nobody in this room, and I'd hedge a big bet, that nobody in this room knows what their polymorphism is for their 5-HTT-LPR. And because of that, there could be an invisible risk. So I'm going to ask all of you, especially the adolescents in the room, that you're going to stand up for your peers who are being harassed at school and never stand by. Thank you.